Good evening, everyone, and welcome to TPA's webinar on BEPS implemented into LATAM countries. What is happening in this region? Our webinar of today will address which BEPS action plans will become effective in LATAM as of 2016, and what will be their potential impact to your LATAM finance and tax books. It will also help you decide how should M&Es with operations in LATAM react to such BEPS-related initiatives, and what solutions are available to M&Es to adopt a proactive approach in being BEPS compliant. We have three speakers for today's webinar. The first one is Hebert Guevara. Hebert is a senior transfer pricing specialist at Transfer Pricing Associates based in Amsterdam. He has worked for Big Four consultancy firms in the UK and Mexico, participating as a transfer pricing manager for the last few years. He has been involved in a number of transfer pricing planning, benchmarking, and documentation projects for M&Es located in Mexico, UK, and now in Europe. He has offered various seminars in Mexican transfer pricing legislation targeted at M&Es with new operations in Mexico, as well as to Mexican companies expanding to other new markets. He will be joined by Carlos Camacho, who is the CEO of Grupo Camacho based in Costa Rica. He is also the founder of International Center of Tax Intelligence, headquartered in Panama. He has authored numerous articles for professional journals and has spoken at numerous professional and academic conferences on international tax planning, transfer pricing, and other related topics. He has also provided training programs to the Costa Rican government personnel to improve efficiency and coordination within the Ministry of Treasury Department. Our last speaker of the evening will be Ramon Lavara. Ramon is a partner at Lavara Transfer Pricing Consulting in Mexico. He has 11 years of full-time experience in transfer pricing services and 8 years in international and Mexican taxes. He has been dealing with designing, analyzing, and implementing and documenting structures and restructuring transactions for M&Es, obtaining cost-efficient and cost-effective structures. He has also been involved in various advanced pricing agreements with the Mexican tax authorities, and has been involved in analysis and implementation of transfer pricing systems and methodologies for large Mexican corporations operating in other countries. With this introduction, I now give the floor to our speakers and we begin our presentation of today. Just one more remark before we start. We would like to reserve all the questions for the end. If you have any questions, feel free to type them in the dialogue box and we will be addressing all of your questions at the very end. Thank you, and I invite Hebert to start now.
Avisha, thank you very much for the introduction, and good morning and good afternoon to the audience. In terms of the structure of this presentation, we would do it in a question and answer format with the speakers. I have received a few questions from multinationals that we're currently providing services to. These multinationals have operations in Latin America. And the thing is that they haven't heard too much about BEPS, how exactly the 15 BEP action points will be adopted by the Latin America countries and tax authorities. And because of that, you know, these questions have been communicated to our panelists. And we would start with Mr. Carlos Camacho. I would raise him a question, and Mr. Camacho will give us his input on how he has seen things in Latin America. On the other hand, we have a very practical case, which is Mexico. Mexico has been seen as a pioneer in the transfer pricing area for Latin America, and that's where Mr. Ramon Lavara will participate. If I start with Mr. Carlos Camacho. General Camacho, good morning to you, and I have a question. So we have 26 countries in Latin America, and again, the fear that my clients have been having exposing is they haven't heard too much on the news. There's not too much information on public sources. The tax authorities have been adopted in a passive way. But is there something happening around BEPS in Latin America?
I guess thank you first to you all to have organized this important talk regarding such a major change in the international tax arena regarding base erosion profit shifting and the impact in the region of Latin America. Indeed, what I can summarize is that most of Latin American countries have had a very passive role regarding the compliance level as far as tax administration is concerned, regarding the way to start implementing measures in order to be in full compliance with the regulations that were released in October. It's quite interesting because the solely case of Mexico as of today is the one that leads the LATAM region regarding the introduction of specific rules that have been adopted already in the internal legislation, and that's where the importance of sharing this dialogue with Ramon is going to become more illustrative as far as the practical or the practicalities of the implementation within Latin America. We can classify those countries in the region amongst three different type of groups. One is the group of the G20. G20 members are going to lead, of course, the changes in the region as they are the main steer of the OECD regarding the program that was created after 2 years of work. And of course, those are supposed to become the leading part, yet the only one that have specifically adopted legislation is Mexico. The rest are just in talking terms, very soft talking terms, and mainly focusing their internal tax affairs more likely than the external tax affairs and the international soft law that is going to have an impact. We're going to also have those countries that are in the process of accession to the OECD, that is the case of both Costa Rica and Colombia, and those other countries that have very minimal impact, if any, so far, regarding the implementation of BEPS in LATAM.
So Camacho, thank you for that. And if I turn to Ramon, Ramon, Mexico is a member of the OECD. So from a political perspective, Mexico cannot be in a passive way as other Latin American countries when it comes to implementing BEPS measures. It somehow reports back to the rest of the OECD members. Mexico also has been, as I mentioned in the past, a pioneer in introducing measures around transfer pricing in its tax legislation. So what can we expect from Mexico?
Yes, as you mentioned, Mexico has been very active in this area. 3 years ago, we started to see some changes in the local legislation, and they were clearly intended to address these base erosion and profit shifting issues that all the countries in the region are facing. In an informal forums and interviews that the Mexican Ministry of Finance has granted, they have mentioned that they have already identified more than 270 companies in Mexico, multinationals, that are very likely to be involved in practices that probably could be considered under this scenario. And they have a very aggressive audit program, and sometimes they publish the results of these audits. And basically, as you mentioned, we now have some more specific topics that have been included in the legislation, and we will be discussing them in the following minutes.
Thank you, Ramon. And going back to Mr. Camacho, Mr. Camacho, we have 15 BEPS action plans. And in Europe and in other developed countries and OECD members such as Australia, Spain, the UK, there has been an active mode in terms of the introduction of BEPS measurements explicitly into the legislation. Some of these BEPS measurements have been introduced straightforward and without really that many modifications, but others have been, they are still in the air, and we don't know how exactly will be translated into local law. But when we turn to Latin America, we don't hear that much, and multinationals are a little bit afraid of unexpected adoption of tax measurements that would not be on their benefit. So from all the 15 action plans, which ones do you see as the most tentative to be introduced in Latin America?
Yes, actually, one of the major problems in Latin America is the legal uncertainty, and that is perhaps across the border situation, and even with the advances shown in the local legislation in Mexico, the legal uncertainty is a reality across the border in Latin America. Having said that, I first don't see very much of room for local legislators to become very creative in introducing major changes when the time comes in order to make amendments of major impact to the proposed action plans in BEPS. Having said that, the way that we foresee the impact as far as risk management concern is classified according to those actions that, according to the main activities in Latin America, we do anticipate may have the most of the higher risk factor. Starting with digital economy, of course, is something that create a lot of challenges. We're going to refer to a specific tax havens situation that might be good shelters for digital economy, and that in itself is going to be one of the major issues for Latin America, mainly for those countries that are going to have less pressure to adopt. The clean capitalization those regarding action four are the, perhaps the broader adopted measurements that have been already taken into consideration by local governments. And the matter of artificial switching or avoiding the PE status is something that basically in major infrastructure contracts, we have foreseen the breakout of contracts amongst related parties, which is one of the issues that the artificial avoidance of the PE will be addressing. Latin America, in some instances, is still a developing area, and there are several major activities going on as far as infrastructure concerns, and that in itself is going to be one of the focus of the activities of tax authorities control. Matters as related to transfer pricing, and mainly those regarding intangibles, we do foresee a major impact mainly for those activities having to deal with a special status. When I refer to special status, I'm referring to those programs promoted by the local governments in order to attract foreign direct investment, such as free zones or foreign zones of tax reliefs that may be very easy to allocate, mainly property IP that might be a deductible expense for the local entity that might not have a major impact as far as the local entity, but it creates an escalation in the cost analysis that is going to be immediately reflected, as far as I can understand and predict, on Action 13, which is the country-by-country report that I will refer to. The transfer pricing risk capital is quite unbalanced in Latin America due to the lack of exportation and a lot of importation of technology, know-how, and intangibles in general that make a very easy switching of the profits on a particular economy that is on developing basically in those transactions that are semi-industrial or industrial as far as Latin America concerns. Those issues regarding the transactions with high risk factors are also matters that are going to be very much addressed to the financial sector And we foresee that that is going to be a major high risk for the LATAM area. The other actions we do not foresee are going to have such a major impact in the short term, and I shall refer to that in the sense of direct impact, because there is going to be indirect impact anyways.
Thank you, Mr. Camacho. And if I turn now to Ramon. Ramon, Mexico is the second largest economy next to Brazil, after Brazil, sorry. And depending on the economic momentum that the Mexico is leaving, other Latin American countries will also follow. It's a cascade effect. Mexico will be seen, because of that, as, you know, a stepping stone. Whatever Mexico does, other Latin American countries may follow. But which of the 15 action plans do you see that represent less of a risk for multinationals operating in Mexico?
Well, very well in line with what just Carlos said. I would say that probably the most important of the ones that would be having a more concrete impact in the operations of multinationals companies in Mexico will be the action 4 regarding interest deductions. We will discuss that later, but we already have very specific think capitalization rules in Mexico since 3 or 4 years ago. And also a key issue here would be the available information that the tax authorities are gathering through different requirements that they have established. And they have now a very robust, I would say, kind of database or information about companies and transactions. But also, the tax authorities in Mexico have been very proactive signing and agreeing with other countries the exchange of information. So this would be a key issue for other countries. I would say that in the case of the tax authorities, having more information is a key factor to conduct more specific and effective audits, and they have seen the results regarding that. And also, as you said, Mexico is the third country in the region with most digital economy transactions in the area. So I think that will be the next step that the Mexican tax authorities will be attacking. As you know, there are so many transactions and there are so many, I would say, gray areas in that regard. So probably we will see in the near future some changes regarding this specific issue.
Thank you, Ramon. And now, you know, we see that BEPS is a big monster, and a lot of things have been happening in other parts of the world, but we don't see again which of these measures will be really introduced in Latin America and how exactly are they going to be introduced. I guess some of it would depend on, again, whether a country is a member of the OECD or is just in ascension stage or is just part of the G20. But then at some point there will be pioneers and others to follow. Mr. Camacho, what can we expect then from those OECD members that are in Latin America and also from the G20 members that are also Latin American countries? And how would that translate to other countries that are not part of either group?
Yes, indeed the impact is going to be quite escalated according to the classification that is shown in the film. Basically, those members of the OECD and the G20 are going to be the very first ones having an impact in the internal legislation. The main problem we do foresee for the Roman system of law is to adopt soft law. And this is something that is going to be a major issue to be perceived in the next future, as long as OECD recommendations for non-members may turn just into best practices. And of course, the way that this will be implemented will come right from the holding companies, because those are the ones that are going to receive the pressure, for instance, to collect the data, to report the data to the holding companies and the different jurisdictions where the exporters of capital to Latin America are located. Therefore, we do foresee that indeed the first group consists of Argentina, Brazil, Chile, and Mexico as members of the OECD, and those will be pioneering the type of tools that they will be creating for implementation of BEPS. The characteristics of the four tax administrations, therefore, are quite receptive to be aggressive tax administrations anyways without BEPS. So basically, they will be very receptive to adopt legislation to strengthen the controls on foreign investment, and mainly those that have been facing major turndowns in the economy, like Brazil is facing as of now. The accession countries are going to be pleading for knocking the door of the OECD when the peer review is going to take place, and they will really have to make major changes in their legislation. We do foresee major political problems in both Costa Rica and Colombia to be able to adopt legislation. Therefore, tax administrations may be tempted to adopt soft law as opposed to internal law that is quite critical for legal certainty in one hand and for the effectiveness of those rules to be in the practical ground for local activities. Therefore, we can see that this intermediate group might have a very struggling times to come, and the last entering countries will only be pressured indirectly by those that have subsidiaries located in their particular countries. And depending on the level of foreign investment of each of the countries, the pressure will basically will be hand to hand, and of course with most of the investment source being in the G20 countries, we do foresee that those countries, even if they try to resist the adoption of BEPS, they will be forced by headquarters to implement, at least to fulfill the dues of the holding company. The regulatory framework and legal as well as tax concerns is a very critical situation. For instance, in the case of Uruguay, they expressed that they do not foresee in the matter of transfer pricing, for instance, that there is need for them to create any further legislation regarding the adoption of measurements that align their legislation to BEPS compliance. They do perceive that they have enough in their internal law, and of course this is going to be another challenge for the OECD and the patrolling of the implementation of BEPS in all countries, but in this particular case where there is a specific expression of the tax administration in Uruguay, we do foresee that that might be another type of group of countries that may just perceive no need to implement some of those measurements, creating a huge arbitrage between those legislations that have adopted BEPS and those that have not, creating also these discrepancies and arbitrage of taxation. And there are some struggles still to come as the measurements of how to avoid the availability of countries that are not paying attention to BEPS and the way that the OECD is going to deal with that. That is still a matter to be developed, and we foresee that that is going to create a new era of BEPS international litigation. The potential accession of Peru as a very active economy to the OECD is also one of the residual countries that might be interesting to follow, as the foreign direct investment is been growing on a steady basis in the last 10 years.
Thank you, Mr. Camacho. And if we start talking specifically about the action points, well, let's start with digital economy. Ramon was saying that, you know, Mexico is the third largest country. But then there's not that much commerce, e-commerce in Mexico, or for instance, e-commerce in Latin America, as we see in other regions of the world. We see North America, in the U.S. the largest, and then we see Europe, we have France, we have the Netherlands, Germany, the U.K., and then we see Asia, Australia, China, Japan. But when it comes to, you know, action plan number one, which addresses digital economy, what can we expect? What can multinationals that operate in the e-commerce business in Latin America would expect from that action plan being potentially implemented across LATAM?
Okay, I guess that one... Sorry?
Go ahead, Mr. Camacho.
Yes, I guess one of the issues that we have to figure out here is that even most of the LATAM countries are passive as far as the e-commerce concern, they also serve as shelters for the avoidance of PE matters that are to follow the digital economy. And of course, the network of multilateral agreements, or the lack of them, might be the problem with the way that tax authorities have to deal with this. For instance, I guess one of the countries that is going to be a safe harbor for tax digital economy is Panama, with the very flexible way of sheltering profits as far as their foreign source.
And Ramon, if I now turn to you, Mexico again, it is one of the countries what you know, is trying to adopt the U.S. model of doing e-commerce, and more we see people doing business using that mean. So is action plan number one, are we expecting any introduction of new measures, tax measures in Mexico?
I would say that probably yes, we will see them. As you mentioned, Mexico is an important target for e-commerce, and due to the very robust regulation system that we have here in Mexico, many companies that operate in that area have to establish specific subsidiaries in Mexico, in the country. But as you know, there are so many other related issues that are still in gray area, because with this issue you have a very specific mobility of different functions, risks and assets of the companies. We will start to see different concepts like permanent establishments, virtual permanent establishments, for example, etc. So yes, I think we will see the introduction of different rules to regulate this. And as you know, in June 2016, Mexico will be hosting the OECD ministerial meeting on this matter specifically. So we will have to wait a couple of months to see what's the result of this meeting.
And Mr. Camacho, I have a question from a regional perspective. Considering that e-commerce is new to most of the Latin America, again, just some countries are at the developing stage, I was wondering, do tax authorities in Latin America have enough experience on doing a thorough analysis, transfer pricing analysis, to assess the tax liabilities of organizations doing e-commerce in LATAM?
Basically, the lack of experience as far as transfer pricing in intangibles is tempt most of tax administrations to rather become very aggressive and let the taxation at source, based upon the withholding taxes, which are quite substantial, mainly for intangibles and services, And the question that arises is, how are the tax authorities going to deal with matters like software, where the software can be turned into a merchandise, then turned into a customs matter other than a local taxation matter? And this is something that still creating a lot of litigation across the border of LATAM, and in most of the cases, the lose-lose situation is for the taxpayer.
Thank you, Mr. Camacho. If we move on to the next slide. So we have interest deductibility and financial payments. At least in my career, when I'm working for companies operating in Latin America, I see that there's always an injection of money. An injection of money means that there are some loans, and it comes usually from intercompany loans. What's going to happen there? Because tax authorities in Latin America, they do know that some of these intercompany financial arrangements may be in line with arm's length. So that means that the tax rate is under market conditions, the terms and conditions are under arm's length. However, some of them, they won't. And again, this is something very well known for tax authorities in Latin America. So what's going to happen in that area, Mr. Camacho?
I guess that the way that BEPS is going to impact here is only a reinforcement of what the tax administrations are already been developing in as internal either law, bylaws, regulations, or simple jurisprudence that have basically approached the issue of fin capitalization in a several phase factors. One of them is the approach of the independent banker, whether or not an independent banker would have lent the money to this particular entity under the same terms, conditions, risks, and guarantees that were given by the related party. That is one of the approaches, and in most of the cases, litigation goes again, and the argument from tax administrations is it wouldn't, and the argument of taxpayers, of course, is it would. A lack of transparency in accounting and financial information in some instances create another tier of issues regarding the interest deductibility and financial situation, where many of the multinational enterprises get the financing via their related parties, but this is only a cash pool analysis of the group within the way of management treasury and doing intercompany loans. The other issue, of course, is the other approach, is of course creating ratios. Ratios are just becoming, in one hand, a safe harbor, but in the other hand, are really very out of the reality of the economics in the LATAM countries. We have to figure out and bear in mind that the thin capitalization rules, if only are approached from the viewpoint of debt equity ratio, that might not be considered in the actual reality of startups, medium-sized enterprises, small enterprises, which are going to be across the border affected by the BEPS actions. Because it's true indeed that there, in some instances, legislation is considered thresholds that are high. For instance, when we go back to Action 13, there you have a threshold that really creates a differentiation between the way that an SMA and an M&A will be affected by BEPS. But in this particular action, startups, small, medium enterprises are going to be affected in a broader manner than multinational enterprises, because the debt of option is different than the debt of need, and that is something that is not being considered in the creation of the framework of action number 4.
Thank you, Mr. Camacho. And Ramon, last year Mexico introduced some new measurements around thin capitalization. And then if I read it it sounds like there's no deduction at all. But is that the case?
Well, as you mentioned, the tax authorities in Mexico identified, I would say, three types of key specific transactions. One of them is the interest payments that companies made in Mexico. So in the first scenario, if you have an interest payment and if this payment is made to an entity located in a low tax jurisdiction or is a flow-through entity, then you will not, we will consider the interest as a non-deductible expense. If this, given the fact that you comply with the thin capitalization rule that we mentioned, that the 3-to-1 ratio, and in that case, the accident will be considered as non-deductible. But here it is another piece of information that is interesting. The tax authorities have revealed or have mentioned that they are rejecting the deductibility of interests in those cases where the companies are obtaining a series of losses in the last years. In a, if the company has been in a losing position for 3-4 years, then they can consider that the interests will be not deductible due to the fact that probably if those companies with that history of losses go to the open market to obtain a loan, for sure they will not get anything. So they are assuming that due to this fact, the loan and the interest will be non-arm's length, and therefore they are rejecting the deductibility of interest based on those grounds. So I think it is very important to consider this. Not only to comply with the thin capitalization rule will be insufficient, you need to analyze the structure of the company that is receiving the interest, if it is a taxpayer in the other country involved, basically, and if the company is in a losing position or not.
Thank you for explaining that, Ramon. If we move on to the next slide, please. We have one of the key points that that multinationals operating in Latin America are asking is, in terms of value creation, in terms of substance, here in Europe and also in the Americas and Australia, there has been huge debates and huge challenges by tax authorities in terms of flow-through companies only or shell companies, empty companies, think the Netherlands attack, Switzerland attack, Belgium attack, Luxembourg attack. And we see day-to-day cases like Google, we see cases like Amazon, Facebook, and so on. But in Latin America, most of the times, you know, they are the licensee in this type of IP arrangements, which means that there is money going out of Latin America and going to other countries. And sometimes the question is, where is that money ending up to? Is it ending to the recipient or to the country where there is substance? Is there the economic value being generated also in Latin America, or is it true that all value of the IP generated elsewhere, and because of that, Latin America should only be paying a license for using such IP? Mr. Camacho, in terms of actions plan number 8 to 10, what can we expect in Latin America?
Okay, I guess one of the major challenges of negotiations in Latin America, and this is perhaps going to be one of the triggers for the LATAM administrations to try to implement BEPS, is basically the reason that the most of countries in Latin America are in the paying side. As far as they are in the paying side, the value added created in the local economy is quite minimal. In fact, when you go on a case-by-case basis, there are cases where the value added for the local economy is less than 5%, and the total exports of a huge multinational can be composed of a very good 80% of IP payable to a patent box country, actually member of the G20, which is quite contradictory, and end up into a non-taxable environment or a very easy taxable environment, and all of the sudden, value added created in the country is between 5 and 20%. Therefore, the recharacterization of such an intangible, such a value added, and the substance of the licenses that are transmitted via the intellectual property will face major turndowns as far as the beneficial and benefit test, the analysis of real value added, the substance and documentation of those payments. And the LATAM countries also are the providers of some of the shared services, which is the other side of the coin. And most of the shared services, there is a potential likelihood of getting a redundancies that other multinationals in a more heavy tax environment might be taking advantage of the write-offs, but the substance or the value added in itself, the essence of the chair service is quite of a facade in some of the multinational enterprises. So value added is going to be a major issue. And then the issue of compensation. I guess compensation is going to be one of the issues, is the wrong approach if you go by the compensation approach only, because even when you go back to the transfer pricing guidelines, one of the main objectives of the guidelines is to split apart those transactions that are lack of substance, those transactions that are not deemed to be treated as a matter of transfer pricing. They are deemed to be treated in a fashion that shall be interacted by local law other than just transfer pricing. Something that is lack of essence should not be approached via transfer pricing. And many tax administrations are just entering into discussions with tax payers regarding the price or the compensation for those transactions that, in fact, wouldn't be subject to a transfer pricing analysis.
Thank you, Mr. Camacho. And Ramon, when multinational companies want to enter the Latin American market, or if they're already operating in that market, they want to expand the range of services or introduce a new line of services, most of the times they use Mexico as a stepping stone. If it works in Mexico, then they probably start rolling out to the rest of Latin America within a similar structure. We see franchise agreements, we see licensing for marketing materials, we see licensing for brand names. But again, the question is, if some of these concepts developed elsewhere are new in Latin America, the tax authorities in the specific case of Mexico have been challenging where value is created, arguing perhaps that the Mexican market is adding some specific flavor that adds value to the IP generated that was generated elsewhere?
Yes, that has been the case in the last years. As you said, for the nature of the transactions we have in the region, it is very it's highly probable that we will have to pay something for this kind of materials and intellectual property. And yes, the tax authorities have challenged this. They have specifically asked the substance of those transactions. They want to really have evidence that they are contributing to promote or, let the people know the names, the trademarks, the products, etc. So they want to see if there is really a value on those intellectual properties. And also, they have started to ask the companies if part of that effort that is being performed, and as you said, probably tropicalized, if you will, to the different markets, if that's a part of the work that is being done for the local entities or not. And this is particularly important because not only for the considering the deduction of those payments, because in the near future you don't know what or multinational companies don't know what they are going to do with that specific subsidiary. So if they are they have that subsidiary property, they will be developing a new property, intangible property, that probably could be licensed in other countries and probably is not properly compensated in some cases. So the Mexican tax authorities have focused on this, and they are taking actions on this through different audits.
Thank you, Ramon. Mr. Camacho, and continuing with this, with action plan number 8 and value creation, what would be the key points for that multinationals operating in Latin America or that have the intention of expanding their business in Latin America should be focused on in order to avoid being challenged their IP structures by tax authorities from the LATAM region?
Yes, I guess that the main issue here will be to at first have a clear identification of the type of IP the multinational enterprise is dealing with, whether it's inbound or outbound, the contractual basis of the agreement versus the economical reality and ownership of the IP, matters that are to deal with the economical property, which is the user property other than the legal property, are going to be critical as far as treaty shopping practices that may be and tempt multinationals to locate IP for economical beneficiaries in jurisdictions that are more friendly as far as tax concerns, and the way that the IP is contributing, in fact, to the creation of the value that is actually demonstrated by the income stream. One of the major struggles that the multinational enterprises face during the process of being added is the lack of documentation to really establish a vehicle of linkage between the actual expenditure and the way that this create income. In fact, the otherwise test, how would that income be if the IP wouldn't be there? And that other side of the coin is quite tricky when have to be tested by and proven by the taxpayer. The nature of the transaction should be well characterized, and it should be deemed to be transparent. Can't be treated in a fashion in a country A and in a different fashion in a country B, because this is going to be very easy to be attacked by tax authorities with the multilateral agreements of interchange of information and the way that BEPS 13, which we are going to refer to, is going to break apart those withholds that can be now a risk factor for multinationals. The fact to really show and demonstrate the use of assets, valuable assets, not only the fact that the trademark, the methodologies, the know-how are in place, whether those are proprietary or not, are going to be one of the issues that are going to be critical. If the matter that is trying to substantiate the way to give essence to the contractual forms is not deemed to be considered as proprietary, why to pay for it? Why to have the compensation so high, and why to characterize that as a royalty, for instance, instead of a CCA? Development of the risk factor. What is the risk for the provider of the IP? What is the benefit of the recipient of the IP? Is the other side of the coin for the risk factor? And of course, compensation as the last piece, but very last piece if the test is positive in the other analysis. Again, compensation is one of the focus of most of the tax administrations, and that is the wrong way to start the discussion with the taxpayer, and that creates a lot of legal uncertainty in many of the their jurisdictions in LATAM.
Thank you, Mr. Camacho. And Ramon, tax authorities are well aware of the amount of money that flows out of the country via payment of royalties for technical assistance or for licensing. And it sounds that they're becoming more and more aggressive to the extent that if certain conditions are met, it looks like there's no deductibility for such payments. What's really happening in Mexico?
Yes, that's correct. This is a specific measure introduced regarding base erosion and profit shifting. If the companies are making these payments, royalties and technical assistance, to a company that is considered a flow-through entity, or if that company does not consider that payment as an income, this means it's not taxable in the other tax jurisdiction, automatically the Mexican tax authorities will consider this as an undeductible item. But besides this, and this is a new situation, if you have this kind of payments, you have to specifically demonstrate the benefit that you are obtaining. Even if you have a transfer pricing documentation that establishes that probably it is arm's length, that you are within the ranges, or you have specific comparables, etc., if you cannot demonstrate the benefits that the company is obtaining and how this reflects in the operation or the generation of income, they will specifically reject the deductibility of these payments. And also a very important issue, when you are making the payments to a company that is located in a country with the one Mexico has a double taxation avoidance treaty, in some cases, if the tax authorities consider this appropriate, they will request the taxpayer to confirm that in case of not applying that tax treaty, you will have a double taxation issue. This in order to avoid, you know, treaty shopping and to have some access to a specific benefits from tax treaties that probably the company will not be allowed to have.
Thank you, Ramon. And Mr. Camacho, in terms of creating substance, in terms of documenting the value creation, how can taxpayers be certain, or at least have a little bit more certainty, that their structures, the IPS structures that they have in place and which are affecting, again, the licenses that Latin America is paying for abroad, and how can they ensure that there is some certainty in terms of not being challenging by local tax authorities of those IPS structures? Where should they focus on?
I guess that one of the major issues you just mentioned is not only what is going to be regarding the moving forward, but what is going to be for those things that are already happening. And I should remark that because those transactions that were perfected and performed before BEPS are going to be subject to the test of BEPS. And this is very important. As far as the combination of elements that shall be ready to be tested during the analysis of the IP. That is the trilogy of the accounting financing, the economics of transfer pricing, and the legal ownership and documentation. I guess this is going to be the in-out situation where taxpayers are going to continue face more challenges, and this will end up creating, if not double, multiple taxation worldwide because of the application of the coherent program of BEPS, as the actions cannot be foreseen as separate actions, but as a program in itself.
And once we have all this information in place, my clients and other multinationals that I've been speaking with say it sounds like Latin America, then they are moving. There is something happening, and I need to provide more information than what I was providing in the past. Then they look at Action Plan 13 saying, well, how many of these countries in Latin America have been implemented Action Plan 13, or do I need to make an ad hoc approach just for Latin America? Because not all the Latin American countries are in line with the OECD, they're not OECD members or part of the G20. So in terms of the implementation of Action Plan 13 documentation and CBC, what can Latin America countries are going to do in that regard?
I guess one of the major issues is to bear in mind that LATAM is a recipient, a natural recipient, a net recipient of foreign direct investment. The master file shall be completed for all subsidiaries, despite of the fact that the subsidiary is in an environment that has an adoption or not of BEPS measurements. Therefore, that's where the cross-border effect and the cascade effect is going to take place. Basically, if the holding company parent entity will not be able to have a master file which is duly substantiated with the local files, whether those are statutory for local purposes or not, that will be an incomplete master file. Therefore, the C by C report cannot be completed in an appropriate way. So the only way we foresee that the countries that have yet not make any specific legislation regarding C by C is going to be an indirect impact. But yes, indeed, they will have to be very careful the way they do submit their tax returns and their returns on transfer pricing, because these local files are going to be part of that documentation that is going to be shared by tax administrations amongst the agreements of the Mutual Agreement Assistance Convention, for instance.
I know that in Latin America, most countries have not been implementing Action Plan 13 explicitly, but implicitly some of them, they do require the elaboration of a transfer pricing file. Some of them, actually, the file needs to be submitted along the tax return, or it has to be lodged also. But Mexico, that was one of the pioneers again. Can you tell us a little bit more about it, Ramon?
Yes, as you mentioned, for 2016, Mexico introduced a new requirement regarding information, and is directly related with this country-by-country report. This requirement now has, I would say, three layers of information. First, you have to provide information regarding the multinational group, regarding the economic substance of different transactions, how the multinational group works, how the flow of transactions is established, etc. Then you have to provide some local informative information regarding the parties. And as you know, this is in addition to the returns that we already have, in which you have to include information regarding all your transfer pricing documentation, but very detailed one. Now you have to include information about the, for example, XIC codes, number of observations that you have in a sample, the range that you have determined, the margin that you have obtained, and also you have to include information regarding TP adjustments in case they have been done. And the most important, we have now this requirement of filing this country-by-country report. In the first instance, it is considered that it's focused on Mexican holding companies that have multinationals in different countries, and of course they will have to include this information by country. And they also include a specific rule that a specific multinational of a group here in Mexico could be designated as a representative to file the country-by-country report. So this gives us an idea that they are expecting first to have this type of returns or informative returns for huge Mexican companies that have subsidiaries abroad, but also the possibility that some subsidiary in Mexico for a large group could be considered as a designated part to report this information. This is very in line with the Mexican view that information is key to have a more specific information and audits.
Thank you very much, Ramon, for explaining this. And it looks like, if I make a summary of what we have discussed today, Latin American countries and the tax authorities there, they certainly are moving in a passive way, though, except for Mexico and some others. But they're certainly adopting some BEPS flavor in their legislation. Some of it, as we have mentioned, it's not explicitly, but it's implicitly if we follow the local regulations and if we read about them. So what it means for multinationals is that you should try to see it Latin America, focusing perhaps on Mexico, seeing Mexico, what's happening there. Looking at how the multinationals operating in that country react to it. The CBC report and other implementations happening in Mexico will have effect as of this year, but then we will see the results and the effect in the years to come. It wouldn't be any surprise if other Latin American countries, especially Chile, which is an OECD member, or those who would like to be part of the OECD, start following what Mexico does. We have to see what Brazil does. Brazil is in an economic recession. And there's a huge pressure from multinationals so that it opens its tax system to be more coherent to what's happening elsewhere, or again, in other Latin American countries. With this, we have reached the conclusion of our presentation. I would like to welcome any questions that the audience may have to the panelists. If there are no questions, then here you can see on the last slide the contact details if you would prefer to have direct contact to the speakers or the panelists. Here you can see their contact information. We thank you very much, everyone, for your time today. Avisha, I think that this presentation will be available online.
Yes, this will be available online from tomorrow in a few hours, but just to be on the safer side, from tomorrow onwards, it will be available for download on TPA Global's website. A final request, if anyone has any questions, if you could raise your hands or type it in the chat box. We would like to address it right now. Oh, we have a few questions coming in actually right now. Oh, just one being repeated, I'm sorry. There's the non-deductibility of interest for companies in a tax loss position for some years is stated by law, or is it an interpretation? Tax authorities done case by case. I invite Herbert to take the question or pass it on to one of our other panelists.
Mr. Camacho, would you like to speak about the question from a regional perspective?
Indeed, the non-deductibility of interest is quite frequent, and the secondary adjustment on deemed to be treated as a dividend is a consequence that many, if not all, of the tax authorities in LATAM are tempted to do and are in fact doing.
Thank you, Mr. Camacho. And Ramon, what's the approach undertaken by Mexican tax authorities in that regard?
Yes, it is an interpretation of the Mexican tax authorities, and it's a result of a different audit. I would say that this should be seen in a case-by-case basis, and considering all the facts and circumstances applicable to a specific transaction and company.
Thank you very much, Ramon. With this, it looks like we have no further questions, but again, the contact details of the panelists and the speaker are there in your screen. We thank you very much for your attention today, and we look forward to seeing you in our upcoming web events. Please visit for more information our website, tpaglobal.com. Thank you very much, everyone. Thank you, Mr. Camacho, and thank you, Ramon.